Hello, everyone. Thanks for your patience. I had to get here before quarter after, or the meeting would get canceled, right? Because no, that wouldn't happen. You'd just carry on without your chair. Anyways, we'll call this meeting to order, and we will get to it. There is an agenda here. So I need a mover and a seconder. Moved by Councillor Schell, seconded by Paul. Does anyone have anything to add to the agenda? Yes, Mr. Fink.
Again, could we have an update on transition team work?
Sure.
For other business?
Sure.
Or elsewhere?
And yes, and under other business, I will also speak briefly about the next steps for the members here present. Anything else? Okay, we'll vote on the agenda. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. So now we have the minutes from last meeting, February 1st. Moved by Bob, seconded by Jonathan. Any errors or omissions? Yes, Bob.
Three quarters of the way, a little better down the page, says Mr. Cardwell indicated that he is supportive of the false windows. I think the word "not" was omitted. Third last paragraph.
Important word to have, yes, in there, to if you want the sentiment to be captured. So add the word "not." Clerk has taken note. Any other errors or omissions? Yes, Don.
Page 13. At the bottom, I'd like to clarify that a little bit, and so I'm going to I'll give James a revision. What I'm suggesting is the following. Mr. Taylor suggested that there is space for dormers and stated that a new dormer should copy existing dormers, but with slightly simpler trim design so that it would not be mistaken as original.
Thank you for putting that in writing. Is that okay, James? Okay, so the clerk will incorporate that in the minutes. While we're on the subject of having things in writing, if anyone is thinking of making any amendments to any of the recommendations today, if you have a chance before we come to the item to write it down, it would avoid the circumstance of having to adjourn the meeting temporarily or give a recess to write out the amendment. So it'd be nice if we had it in advance, if you have a chance. Yes, Paul.
One other amendment concerning the Pump House Steam Museum, page 10 at the beginning, it does mention the future extension reading Pump House. There was discussion of whether it should be two words or one word. That discussion isn't recorded in the minutes. However, it can be covered here because it was supposed to be two words rather than one. Yet, in this first bullet, it says "pump house" one word.
I remember your comments, Bob. Clerk has reminded me that I ruled at the time that the exact lettering is not subject to the Heritage Committee's approval, so it's not in order to comment on the letters used.
Yes, as far as approval, but the comment really should have been, could have been recorded without any authorization.
Okay, the clerk is agreeable to putting it in the minutes. Any other errors or omissions? Okay, well then we'll need to approve the minutes with those three changes that the clerk has taken note of, correct? Okay, so as with those blanks filled in by the clerk, he now has that in written form. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Item number four is disclosure of pecuniary interest. Yes, Floyd. Okay, do you need that in writing? Yeah. And we have that in writing, thank you very much. So to remind everyone at that point in time, yes.
Yes, I would also like to declare a conflict of interest with regard to the RCHA.
Okay, and you have it written down? If you could write it down, there should be sheets there, yeah. Just the item on the agenda that refers to, so that I know the clerk reminds me to ask you to leave the room. And as you know, the procedure from the procedural bylaw for Heritage is that you have to leave the room and have no part or influence on the deliberations. No other declarations of pecuniary interest? Okay. Delegations. We have no delegations, but we have a briefing. Mr. Leary is here to talk about an update regarding the Cultural Heritage Property Evaluation and Conservation Project. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thought it would be a good idea to give the committee a sort of update on this project. The consultants have now completed their work, and it is completely now within our hands, and I thought it would be a good way to tie up the loose ends, as we spent a lot of effort and time on this rather significant project. So, as you know, the city's Heritage Property Register includes about 1,200 properties of cultural heritage value throughout the city. However, you also know this doesn't include the breadth of heritage value and heritage resources that are within the city jurisdiction. So the Cultural Heritage Property Evaluation Conservation Project was initiated in 2014 as part of the city's efforts to support the conservation of its cultural heritage resources. The purpose of the project is to research and evaluate a number of properties for their possible cultural heritage value and interest, and to prepare statements of significance for those properties that warrant further conservation, such as designation or listing. The city's register, just as a reminder, includes properties that are designated both by the municipality and the province, as well as National Historic Sites, our UNESCO World Heritage Site, and properties that are of cultural heritage value that are not designated, are commonly known as listed properties. Archaeological Research Associates, ARA Heritage, was retained in January of last year, 2015, to do an assessment of 144 properties that were divided into five phases. And they have now completed this evaluation. I wanted to give, for those who haven't seen the reports that were produced by the consultants, they undertake, this is just an example of one that I thought would be helpful. This is a property, we got one screen up. Mr. Clerk, can we have both screens, or is it not working? It's not working? Okay. This is a property just in Westbrook. I'm using it as an example. The consultants do a site visit. They take recent pictures of the property. There's a recent air photo showing the context of the property. Historical mapping, there's usually a number of historical maps that are included in their assessment. It's hard to read from up there. Actually, there is one in your agenda package if you'd like to reference it. Not this one, but one for 25 Colburn, which I believe is on page 59 of your agenda. So first they do a bit of a background. They do it in point form to make it easily referenceable. They break it up based on the three, as you can see in the next slide here, is the three main criteria under the Ontario Heritage Act for evaluating heritage properties. And so they break up their research into the design value, the history. There's usually a second page that has to do with contextual value and the like. Then they take the same information and they rank it against the criteria in Ontario Regulation 906. So these are the three main criteria. My cursor's not working. The physical design, historical associative, and the contextual value, and then the subcategories that go with that. And the check marks, this property meets or exceeds those requirements. And the most important part of that is the last part there, which is their recommendation. So the property is recommended for no further action, for listing, or for designating. In this case, it was recommended for designation.
Ryan, is there any way of getting one page to be able to read it better, to get it bigger, or is that just the whole slide the way it is?
I'm afraid not on here, but if you'd like to look at your agenda package, there are this, not this particular one, but there's one just like it. I'll have it from you. I believe it's page 59.
So that's the designation. On page 65, you see the chart for the case of that particular one on Colburn Street. So that's the gray chart there on page 65.
So where properties are recommended for either listing or designation, the consultants have drawn up a statement of significance. Now this statement of significance, usually a couple pages long, it is the part of the report that we use for either the designation bylaw, if it's recommended for designation, or listing report, if it's recommended for listing. And there's always a second page that includes a list of heritage attributes, which are very important. They usually outline their references. They include copies of abstracts from the register and some historical photos where necessary. So the result of the evaluation, 144 properties were evaluated. All of those reports were reviewed and commented on by the Historic Properties Research Working Group, and I personally like to thank them for all their effort and time. We had three or so all-day meetings where we went through each of these reports in detail and provide comments back to the working group, or to the consultants, and the consultants were amazed every time they got comments about how detailed the evaluation was, the review was. So I thank everyone for that. The resulting recommendations was 95 new designations, 7 updates. Some of the phase 3 were updates of existing bylaws that actually came as recommendations from this committee, Heritage Committee. Places like Nicholson Meat Market that had a big alteration a few years ago, the Anglo-American Hotel on Ontario Street that had some alterations, additions, S&R building, a few of the big changes in the committee recommended that those old bylaws be updated. So they were included in this project. We also had 31 new listings recommended. The notification that we're proposing for the owner's benefits in these cases, the next steps, I suppose, for this project, is to provide the owners the copy of their bylaw, copy of these reports for their properties by registered mail. We're going to proceed and follow that up with phone calls to the owners where we can, and offer meetings if they wish to come in and chat. Following consultation, the usual Heritage Act process will take place for the designations, where we bring the draft bylaw to this committee for review. The notice and counsel for approval, the notice of intent goes out, 30 appeal period starts. So that process will be followed. With the listing, we are going to send out copies of the listing reports and the reports by registered mail and bring a grouping of the listings to this committee for consultation and follow up with a courtesy letter to the owners. It's staff's intent to work collaboratively with the owners of these various properties to dispel myths that go along with designations and to provide a simple and efficient approval process for necessary alterations. However, it is reasonable that not every owner is going to be supportive of the designation. So we will do our best to work with them as best we can. And in some cases, though, staff may recommend proceeding and moving the designation ahead if the owner is still not in favor, and particularly if that property is considered a high priority. The designation, so we'll follow the Heritage Act process for designation. As you know, owners don't have to agree to designate their properties. So the next step for this project, given the number of properties, as I said, 95 new designations, And there's a number of them that we did, and there's a few pictures of them. But given the number of properties that are recommended for designation, we can figure it probably take a good 2 years to get through all the designations. We're hoping 24 months, but it is a lot to go through. So what we propose is that we'd like to bring a report through this committee to list all 126 properties. That includes the 95 designation and the 31 listed, recommended for listing properties. That way, the properties get a minimal level of heritage protection on them while we work through that 24-month process of designating the 95 properties. As I mentioned, we'd like to rank those designations to focus staff's effort on the designations. And the criteria that we came up with is four main levels, or four main criteria. The level of heritage value, so how many check marks they got, essentially. A high ranking or high property is one that will reach higher. The level of visibility, public visibility and legibility. People can walk by and see these properties, know their heritage properties, I think that ranks higher. The age of the property. I know in the Heritage Act that's not typically a characteristic, but properties that predate Confederation are a good one to rank higher than those that are maybe a little more modern. And finally, the level of potential threat to the properties. So if we know that there is development in the area or the property is falling to disrepair or what have you, something that might rank a little higher as well. So our intent then is once ranked, we would notify the property owners and follow the program that I described. And it is our hope that through education, discussion with the property owners that we'll be able to designate all 95 of these properties successfully. So that's the project to date. These are just a few photos of some of the properties that we uncovered through this project. Some of them have been really quite interesting and surprised that they've been lost to time. So thank you, Mr. Chair, and I can take questions.
Thank you, Ryan. I am not a member of that working group, but I have attended a couple of times, and I mean, I'm also very, very impressed with the high quality of the work done there and with Ryden's leadership. A couple of quick questions. The timeline, you were mentioning having a one whole package come at the same time with all of these listings and designations to a meeting. Do you have any idea of when, roughly, what quarter that would be?
I should say, Mr. Chair, I failed to mention that there's an information report. Essentially, what I just told you is on the March 22nd council agenda for information. So barring a successful process through council, I'm hoping we can start that shortly thereafter.
Right. Sooner the better. So council approval is required for that strategy to be taken, basically. It would be a big report, I guess. The other question has to do with, just dividing them down by Heritage Conservation District. Out of those, did you have a category for ones that were within a Part 5 designated area and ones that were not, out of the ones that you've identified?
Well, in actual fact, none of them are within the Part 5 designation. These properties that are up here are either had zero protection on them, most of them, 98% of them had zero heritage protection on them, or they were ones that had an old bylaw that was recommended by a committee to be updated. So we wanted to focus our efforts and consultants' efforts on ones that are vulnerable, essentially.
And I'm assuming that the priority that you're speaking of is based on the principles of why properties need designation in the first place. So the urgency of the designation is directly related to the reason that they need to be designated. In other words, not necessarily which attributes, but their context, as you were saying, the various attributes, the types of attributes mm-hmm. that you mentioned all have to do with urgency and the reason for heritage preservation legislation in the first place. that correct?
That's correct. They're it's based on the Heritage Act criteria for designation. And when we prioritized them, it was just adding a few extra, because they were all assessed with using the same criteria, and it was just a way of flagging those ones that we want to do first. So we added in a couple extra things that we thought might elevate a certain property above another one. So
right, because it is a longer process, there will be delays. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Any other questions from member of the committee? Yes, Mac.
Thank you. At one point, all the buildings are designated were put into books. I think the last one that was done, I think Queen's University did one of a bunch of their heritage properties. Is there any plan in the future to do this again?
That is above my pay grade, I'm afraid. That sounds like a great idea, Mac, but it's certainly not in my work plan, I'm afraid.
Is anyone else from staff here able to answer? Yes, well, either one.
Through you, Mr. Chair. So that's not part of the work plan at this time, but it's something we can think about moving forward.
Thank you, Mr. Newman. Any other questions? Floyd?
I saw some maps up there, and you have charts. But I'd like to know if all listed properties and all designated properties that you are evaluating or listing or keeping a record of, are they all correctly described legally as to their meets and bounds, their property boundary? Because when you start to deal with a property, the lawyers will want to know that first. So you have meets and bounds, length and width, every time. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, as part of our process when we designate properties is we consult with our legal staff and we get a proper full legal description from them. Because essentially the bylaws are registered on title, so to do that, the legal descriptions have to match. So absolutely, that's a step that we will undertake.
Great. Councillor Schell?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll say this when we bring this to council. I think people, including myself, were astonished at how many buildings had nothing. Downtown, beautiful downtown buildings, and everyone talks about downtown and heritage and don't realize that they're walking past buildings that anyone could offer, could say, I want to tear it down. And they would be within their rights within 10 days unless we do one of these great big emergency broom bailey things. So I commend everyone involved who has been working on this project and thank staff for bringing it forward because I think this is leaps and bounds ahead of where we've been. And of course, listing all these properties at least gives them protection. We will have a ton of information about them so that if someone does want to tear one down, council doesn't have to go hunting. The work has already been done. So thank you very much for this.
Yes, and if anyone, just as an interjection, if anyone is interested in the historical context of this, we started a list of properties in the early 70s. And this list is bound form in book form down in the Heritage Resource Center if you haven't seen it already. Top left of the back bookcase in the Heritage Resource Center, and you can just open it up. There's a foreword by the mayor of the time of each volume, and then pictures and designations attributes of a list that started back in the early 70s. So this is evolution, right, of the things that Kingston specifically has done within and even predating the Heritage Act, which was 1975. Any more questions? Yes.
I just wanted to thank you, Ryan, for all your work in leading this.
You're welcome.
Don.
Ryan, just a question about procedure. You mentioned that all these properties are going to City Council as an information report, but to act on them, City Council will need a recommendation from this committee, I assume, which we are doing for a small subset today. And I guess the minor point is when these come before this committee, there might be an occasional amendment or modification, and so that is all okay. There's no problem with proceeding in this way.
Yeah, just before you answer, I'm assuming, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that this briefing we got today will be similar, will be coming to council as an information report. Is that correct, right? So information reports at council are not debatable. Councilors are allowed to ask questions such as these we're hearing today. So it'll be very similar to this format.
Mr. Chair, the only thing I would add is that certainly when we start proceeding with listing the designation, the Heritage Act requires that each of those stages that the Heritage Committee is consulted. So certainly there'll be an opportunity to go through each of these in detail. Today you just have a taste of one designation and a series of listings, but it'll be that same process, just bigger.
Anyone else? Unfortunately, members of the public are not allowed to comment at this time, but you will have a chance to comment later on. Perhaps when we talk about the specific designation, if you have a more general comment, you can make it at that time. Okay, well, my compliments as well. Thank you very much, Ryan. I know it was a heck of a lot of work.
It's good. It's interesting. Yeah. I quite enjoyed it, actually. That's why I do this.
That's great. Okay, well, that was the briefing. Again, back to the agenda. We are now on item 7, which is the meat of the agenda, I like to call it. Item 7 is business. There's Section A and Section B. Section A is staff reports that include the applications for heritage permits. Today we have two applications. In addition to the register and a notice to designate. So we'll start with the first one, and we've got Amy from staff here to introduce. Yes, James is reminding me that the lighting is a technical problem that started council last week. Apparently there's a problem with one of the lights, and also this screen is not functional either, so that's why there's things are only on that one screen, and why it's so dark in here. So this first one is for the heritage permit for 340 King Street East, which is in your package, pages 1 to 13.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The committee will recall at the last meeting that the heritage permit for the ground floor renovations were reviewed for this property. At the time, signage information wasn't available, but has since been submitted as part of a heritage permit application. This property is located on the north side of King Street East within the Lower Princess Heritage Character Area. It's designated under Part 4 and is adjacent to the Market Square Heritage Conservation District. The existing building was constructed in 1891 and was designed by William Newlands. The application requests approval to install signage on the ground floor, as illustrated in the rendering on the screen, for a new commercial tenant. The signage is composed of individual lettering, which will be include internally illuminated letters spelling COCO 70, as well as non-illuminated orange letters on either side of the sign. Two gooseneck-like fixtures are proposed, as well as repainting the cornice and brackets or modillions in the existing coloring. Staff reviewed alongside signage policy signage should be designed to be compatible with heritage attributes of designated properties and should be proportioned to fit between openings in the facade and should not conceal any heritage attributes. It was noted in staff's review that the wording, the center letters, were fairly close to the modillions or the brackets under the cornice, but through follow-up discussions, I've been assured that those features will not be impacted. A condition's been put in the recommendation of approval just to emphasize that understanding. With the lighting in the adjacent Market Square District, there's guidance to consider lighting carefully. Gooseneck lighting is generally preferred in Market Square. For the internal illumination, the sign designer was able to could reduce the intensity of the lighting, so a condition's been included in the recommendation of approval that a lower intensity of light be included in the final design, as well as standard conditions related to the encroachment, satisfying the encroachment requirement with the city's engineering department and the sign permit. So staff have no concerns after reviewing against legislation and policy and recommend approval. The property owner, I believe, is here and can answer questions not covered by the staff report.
Thank you. So there's now questions for committee members. And I just have a quick one that's just for context. Can you just explain the when something is adjacent to a Part 5 designated area, in this case Market Square, where the boundary for that Market Square lies and how the definition for adjacent works for this building?
Well, the property or the boundary for Market Square District is right along this side of the building here. It cuts right along the property line. And adjacent, using the definition in our official plan, means directly beside or across, I believe, a right-of-way or a road. So that policy doesn't apply directly to this property, but it's good guidance for the area.
Well, the Part 5 legislation does include language about adjacent properties to the areas, correct?
It may. I know as part of planning applications, we certainly consider adjacent properties because of the provincial policy statement. But
I see you and I have the same amount of not quite sure. Ryan, or does anyone know if this is a city practice or something directly arising from Part 5 of the Heritage Act, the adjacent feature?
Mr. Chair, the only thing I could add, I suppose, is when the district is set with certain boundaries and the policies are only contained within those boundaries. So properties that are adjacent to a district aren't subject to any of the policies of the district. If you're doing a planning application next door to a district, what that means is that that development needs to take care that it's going to be compatible with or not impact greatly the heritage value of the district itself. But in this case, we have a Part 4 property which has a bylaw that goes with it and a list of attributes that go with it. And that's what we need to base any alterations on is the impact on those attributes.
Right. So from the point of view, just to clarify again, from the point of view of the Heritage Act, it's the Part 4 section that applies to this building directly. And the Part 5 is mentioned sort of in passing, but it's outside of the Part 5 area. If it was a property that was adjacent to a Part 4 designation, it would apply under the Planning Act because on the Planning Act, you take into account adjacent properties in the planning application, is that correct? I'm just trying to resolve this because I've never quite understood how this adjacent thing works.
The adjacency, Mr. Chair, only applies for the Planning Act. Heritage Act doesn't care if you're adjacent, but what you're adjacent to, as far as that goes. You're either a Part 4 or Part 5, or sometimes both, which has its own little tricks, but in this case, we have a Part 5 next to a Part 4. So the Part 5 really has no bearing in this case.
Right. So it's mentioned in passing. The Part 4 is what's relevant, and it's the Planning Act that talks about adjacency. Okay, thank you. Bob.
Just a question. Being adjacent, it would generate the necessity of an HIS. And if it was a larger project, something of this magnitude, though, is really... perhaps beyond that, but theoretically adjacent to a district, or it would generate, I believe, an HIS application.
Staff have a comment about the decision to agree with the application without requiring an HIS?
Due to the nature of the application, a heritage impact statement wasn't thought to be necessary. It's
Yes, Paul.
Can you clarify the gooseneck lamps? It's really hard to see. I guess the wording is going to be under there, but how will they illuminate the wording if they're pointing directly down, or are they going to be sort of pointing closer to the wording? I'm not sure how it's going to illuminate the wording.
Perhaps the administration is the owner of the property, or the be able to answer that. Do you? I know her name, but I'll ask her. If you could just come forward to a microphone, I know your name, but if you could just state it for the committee.
Wait.
Well.
If you just give me a second, I'll give you a chair. Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Hurdle. Hi. Very chivalrous.
Dorothy Lloyd for Lloyd Properties, and the tenants are not able to attend today. We could, we've been asked to call them if there are specific questions that we need their answer to. I believe that the lighting is more to illuminate the whole area as opposed to just the specific wording on either side of Coco 70. So it's general lighting that would be hanging down.
It makes sense. From the light would be coming from the rendering, that's what it looks like. So two different things, I guess. Any other questions, Paul? All right, and I saw, I believe, Max's hand. And did Ms. Agnew have something to say?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I was just going to provide clarity on the question regarding adjacency in HIS. We do have policies in their official plan, so it's not just a planning act, but it's also in our official plan. So depending on the nature of application in this case, because it's to do with something that's more relatively minor, it wasn't required to have an HIS, but under other circumstances of a more complex application, one would be required typically.
Thank you. Mac.
My question is similar to Paul's. I think in the notes you said that they're illuminated wording and that sort, but so there isn't actual lights in the lettering. It's just illuminated by those two lights. Is that?
There's internal illumination on the Coco 70 lettering, but the chocolate and bistro aren't illuminated. The orange writing on either side.
So how is the Coco 70 illuminated?
Through internal, like an internally illuminated lettering.
And what is the lettering made of?
The materials. The specifications say LED internally illuminated channel lettering, face translucent plexiglass, white powder coated painted metal on either side of the frame. The materials weren't.
So are these letters individually mounted then?
I believe so.
So there's individual lights coming for each letter then, I guess? So it's like there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so there's 7 wires coming through the wall to light that, or how does that, I'm just curious how that works.
Just not being a sign designer myself that was my understanding. Sorry.
Ms. Lloyd, if you have anything to add.
Doesn't really show any of that, right?
It does appear from the drawing that they are individual, but I do not have the definitive answer to that. We would have to ask them.
So, and that's an excellent question from a technical representative of this committee. Maybe staff could try to follow up and reply.
And I think, I mean, typically the sort of flags that we look for in installing individual lettering, if it were onto masonry, then the attachment into the masonry would be a potential concern. But in this case, the don't think there's a potential for an impact with the type of attachment in this case. I'm happy to follow up directly.
I'm just curious. I mean, you've got, it looks like individual letters. It looks great. I don't have a problem with it. But, you know, is there a bar that goes behind that might, you know, I'm just.
This is the type of thing what we get into when there's a rendering. It doesn't necessarily have every small detail in the rendering, such as where's the lighting coming from, right? Where the wire is coming from. How do they make it to the individual lights? It might not be in the rendering. It's not a photograph, right? It's not a photograph. This is a rendering, which is often incomplete as far as those types of details. So I don't know what we can do here, really. Unless we had the sign designer here, we can't really...
Well, maybe since she can call them, they could do that and come back and report to us later in the meeting. I'm just curious if there's going to be a strip that goes across that would take away from how it looks.
Right.
So
specifically, anything visible on the facade that would have to do with the wiring?
Yeah, I'm just curious how that works. Yeah.
Okay. Is there any way you could try to get that answer before the end of today's meeting? Okay. Yes, we'll move on and we'll come back to that. Councillor Shell.
Well, I was wondering if we should defer this now to the end of the meeting.
Okay, so need a seconder for the motion to defer. It would be within the meeting. That's fine. Mm-hmm. Seconded by Paul. So it's debatable the time or place. So she's saying defer to later today. So that's the only thing you can speak to. You can't speak whether you're in favor or not of deferral. You can only speak to the time. James has made a valid point. If there's any other questions we have for the sign designer, we should note them before we call them. So does anyone else have, before we vote on deferral, any other questions for the sign designer? Yes, Bob.
I have two. The light-colored strip that's below the lettering, the lettering seems to overlap onto it. I can't really tell from the photographs whether that is on a different plane to the flat board against which the lettering is placed. If it is slightly raised, that strip, the lettering then would have to be proud of that wooden background.
Okay, so is that clear what that question would be for the designer? About the plane that the sign lies on?
That photo shows it well.
So just to recap, my understanding is there are two questions. One is the plane of the lettering and whether it protrudes a little bit out from the building, so that that's how it is set, and whether each letter is an individual application or whether there are some bars connecting the letters, and in what way is it attached to the building?
Yes. So if there's any visible infrastructure for the lighting, okay, that would be visible on the facade, that wasn't contained in the rendering. Yes, Bob, you have a second item?
The second question concerning the lighting and how the lighting is affixed. I'm not sure what the material is of the flat panel in the architrave above the, where the awning is mounted. What material? Is it wood or is it some kind of masonry product?
My understanding was that it was wood.
Anyway, the question is where and how is the lighting affixed? Is it being affixed to that panel? Which isn't a problem, as far as I'm concerned.
Maybe you could restate the question. I don't think staff understood. Sorry, say the question again.
How is the lighting affixed to the facade? The two lights.
How is the lighting affixed to the you're talking about the gooseneck lighting now?
Yes.
How is it affixed?
My understanding was that it comes from over top the cornice, but perhaps this designer can clarify exactly. I'm not sure what the intent of the question is.
Yes, Jonathan.
I'd just like to make a, thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a quick note to just my observation of this. Obviously, the stuff that's there has to be taken down, the awnings, right? There's a conduit that's already to the right over the thing. And I would think the big deal is, I guess what we're getting at, is that the dental work is not interrupted. Because it looks like it's overlapping that, and I think that's kind of what people are getting at, is that the dental work is not, you know, impeded, and the trim in the bottom is not impeded. So, Mac, was that kind of what you were saying, that you wanted to kind of stand back so that it would be, you wouldn't have, they wouldn't be cutting into those particular details?
That wasn't my particular question. That was more Bob's question, but it's a good question, though. You know, it's whether those are standing out so they don't impede that bottom trim piece or not. I believe that's the way it looks, but...
Also the
that dentals, also that also the allows dentals. The letters to be larger, which clearly it shows.
Just so I was going to make sure I'm on the same page. Yep.
Yes, Paul.
Didn't there was a comment when we were first starting, there was an amendment for a recommendation that this lettering was going to be smaller so that it wasn't going to do the dentals. Was that correct?
The condition in the recommendation is that the wording not impact or damage the brackets under the cornice. Which is the key feature that was focused on in this case.
Paul brings up the question, so which is a procedural one, is that if we are worried about the signage affecting the heritage features of the facade, we should suggest an amendment that would contain a condition to that effect. It may not be necessary if the answer is from the sign designer is sufficient, but before we go down that road, maybe we should give time for the sign designer to reply. And then, so maybe if there's any other questions, I will entertain them, but if we start getting into sort of, you know, our judgment of the application, then we need to deal with the motion to defer by Councillor Shell. Yes.
Since we're past that, just a question, what time? As opposed to deferring to the end of the meeting, maybe we could defer it to just the end of the projects before we get into all the heritage discussions about all the buildings that we're proposing to be designated.
Okay,
that's just so excellent. They don't sit down for the rest of the...
Totally in order what you just said. So I'm looking at the movers. So the time would be to the end of this section of business, so 7A. And that should give at least an hour's time to get an answer from the sign designer. So, and we had, was that seconded, James? Was, or is it? So, okay, so we're now in a motion to defer. So, and Mac has made an in-order suggestion to defer to the end of 7A. Any other comments on the timing of the deferral? That's the only thing that's in order right now. Because if it's deferred, we will, when we pick up again, we will continue with the discussion. Okay. So it was seconded by Paul, and this is motion to defer to the end of section 7A. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. So we'll come back to this. So Ms. Lloyd, you have about an hour more or less to try to get an answer about those sign concerns surround basically the impact on the facade of the signage. Okay. Yes, Bob.
It's just that usually there are technical drawings that go along with the aesthetic drawings that have been presented. Those would help, perhaps, if they've already been prepared.
If staff has any further photographic material they could bring to us, we could look at it. Is that what you're suggesting?
Technical drawings.
Oh, technical
installation
drawings.
Do
we have technical drawings? Yeah. We don't have any. Okay, we're coming back to that. That is now the last item of 7A. We're going to move on to Roman numeral 2. Thank you, Ms. Lloyd. And thank you, Commissioner Hurdle. If any, in the, just to avoid having to displace Commissioner Hurdle repeatedly, we have an open microphone on this side at the end here beside Mr. Newman, and we have one over here, a couple over here for members of the public on that side. Okay, so Roman numeral 2 is 193-195 Ontario Street Heritage Permit Application. Pages 14 to 31 in your package. There's a recommendation. Please, if you're thinking of an amendment, start working on it in writing as soon as possible. Go ahead, Amy.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. The subject property is located on the south side of Ontario Street, adjacent to Confederation Park and the Market Square District. Property was designated under Part 4 in 1976, and the three-story limestone building was built in 1848, designed by architect William Coverdale. This application is also signage-related. The application requests approval to install two rectangular signs on both street-facing facades on Ontario Street and Clarence Street. The signage is intended to improve the street presence of a restaurant tenant on the ground floor of the property. Existing signage includes two small circular signs, which were approved by the reviewed by the Heritage Committee and approved by Council in 2013. Staff reviewed alongside policy related to signage and the attributes of the property, and note that the proposed location is located underneath second-story windows, or the positioning does not have the effect of concealing any stone detailing. On the Clarence Street side, there's already some awnings that partially obscure some stone voussoirs, but the location of the sign will not have any further impact than in addition to the awnings. The recommendation of approval is conditional on relatively standard conditions related to obtaining a sign permit and a sign variance, as well as consistency with the masonry policy with attaching the attachments to masonry that the sign will be attached with, be consistent with the masonry policy. And I believe the applicant is here.
Yes, so Mr. Pater is here to answer any questions about the application. He's the owner of the restaurant in question. Does anyone from the committee have questions? Yes, Paul. And please state if it's to staff or to the applicant that you direct your question.
Probably the applicant at this time.
Yeah, so there's a, thank you. Go ahead, Paul.
Yes, sir. The signs on the drawings we have on page 22, it looks like it covers over the existing flood lighting. Is that correct, or will they be removed?
Hit the little button.
It covers the channel that the wire is in. The actual lights will remain on either side of the signs.
Thank you. Any other questions to applicant or staff? We're just in question period right now. Yes, Mac?
The corner signs you have now that hang off the wall, those are staying then?
Yes.
Okay. And have you changed the name?
Yes, we did. Okay. Fish Bar wasn't working.
But the corner sign will say the old name?
You can just leave the mic on.
Oh, just leave it on. Okay. The old signs were replaced with updated version of the new name. They were consistent with what was approved. All we did was change the bottom lettering on them.
So there's nothing in this application about building a shack, correct?
No shack.
Any other questions? Okay, so now we go to questions or comments from members of the public. Seeing none, we'll go to deliberations. We have a recommendation that needs to be moved and seconded, and then we can discuss it. Moved by Mac, seconded by Bob. And would anyone wish to speak to the recommendation? Okay. Well, then we're ready to, yes, Don.
Perhaps this should have been a question earlier, but I'm referring to those lights that I guess Paul referred to. Looking at page 27, for example, there's some electrical conduit servicing a number of floodlights. Some of those lights illuminate the sign, but further along the wall, it looks as if there are sort of floodlights which simply point upwards. And I think that's not really considered appropriate lighting in cities' bylaws these days. So what is going to happen to these lights when the sign is in place?
Okay, before we go any further, maybe staff could confirm whether the lighting that referred to by Mr. Taylor is part of the application?
No, it's not part of the scope of work. They're existing.
Right, so you've noticed this in the photos, but it is not relevant to the recommendations on the floor. Any other deliberations? Keep in mind the applicant is the owner of the restaurant on the first floor. The building itself is owned by the Royal Canadian Horse Artillery. No further deliberations. We'll call the question on the recommendation in the package. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. Congratulations. Thank you very much. Is he being interviewed by somebody?
Paging Mr. Grenda, paging Mr. Patterson.
Okay, well, we're going to move along. They'll get here soon enough. Roman numeral 3. So this is the addition of non-designated properties to the Heritage Register. There's several addresses listed in the package on Ordon Street, Sydenham Street, Highway 2, Nelson Street, Princess Street, Highway 15, Sydenham Street, and Colburn Street, and Isle of Man Road. Yes. And is it Ryan? Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just as a quick introduction to this project, the report before you is the consideration of adding 9 properties to the register as listing properties. That includes a limestone semi on the corner of Ordnance and Sydenham Street. They have 2 addresses, but it is one building. It's 2 properties, but it's one building. The Jack Houses, which is on Highway 2, it also includes a stone house on Sandy Beach Lane, which is, again, the same property. In this case, it's 2 buildings on the same property. An arts and crafts style house on Nelson Street, the Baxter House, which is the Greenwood Inns on Highway 15, the Allen Theater, or also known as the Capitol Theater, Empire Theater on Princess, a brick commercial building on Sydenham Street between Princess and Queen, and a property on Colburn Street known as the Richard Boyd House, and a log house, former log house on Isle of Man Road. So just quickly, listing properties is simply a way of inventorying properties of cultural heritage value and adding them to the register. There are no bylaws associated with these, nothing registered on title, and the owners will not have to come into this through this committee or into the city at all for alterations. However, should they wish to demolish a listed property, they do need to give the city 60 days notice, and in that time, council can decide whether they want to designate or whether they simply want to take pictures for archival purposes. And while it's not required, it has been our practice to evaluate these properties under the criteria in the Heritage Act, Regulation 906. And you'll note in your agenda packages from pages 39 through 54 is a small write-up on each property with a picture on the heritage value of these properties. They have, again, been reviewed by the Historic Properties Working Group. and have been recommended by both that group and staff that they meet the provincial requirement for being listed. So, Mr. Chair, that is our recommendation that this committee endorse that and suggest to council that they add these to the register.
Sorry, I missed whether you mentioned this or not. Was this work separate from the earlier work that you were talking about?
Mr. Chair, yes and no. Seven of the nine properties are independent work by the working group, some of them based on information from other heritage professionals. Two of them, the one on Colburn and the one on Sydenham Street, it's proper, are properties that came out of the Cultural Heritage Property Evaluation and Conservation Project.
Great, thank you. Any other questions from members of the committee? Peter.
This is just for information. It's very interesting that there are two sources for the list on here. I found, looking through this material, some of the most fascinating stuff I've read for this committee, actually. What is there a possibility that owners may ask, may approach the committee and ask for things to be listed? And has it happened?
Yeah, go ahead.
Mr. Chair, it does happen. It can happen. I hope it continues to happen. These properties, I don't think we were approached to have them added. They came to us through various sources. But certainly that's an option that we encourage. And the owners have been circulated all this information and actually in some cases have supplemented with information that they had to add to the report. So, yeah.
Yes, Don.
I think these descriptions have come through the working group and we're, as a member, I think we're all in favor, but there in a couple of places, I'd like to suggest a slight correction or amendment, and I wonder if we could just go through them and mention them.
Hang on, just hold that thought and wait till we get to deliberations, and then we'll do so.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Just questions only at this point. Seeing no further members of the committee, members of the public have a chance to comment or ask questions. Yes, Ms. Go ahead. If you want to just come on over here.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Frank Dixon, Williamsville resident. So I'm going to commend this great work. I just had one suggestion. Now that we have the new Heritage Center in operation, I'm wondering if photographs of these properties, along with maybe a small description, could be displayed there on an ongoing basis as this work continues, so that visitors to the center can not only see the work that's being done by staff and the committee, but also to get a feel for the whole process of heritage designation. Thank you.
Okay, just to see if there's any other questions from members of the public, and then we'll get staff to answer them all. Any other questions? Did you want? Yes, go ahead. If you just turn on your mic.
I haven't read this one, but it has to do with 25 Colburn, and I wondered if there's anything in here which will protect the mantelpiece particularly, which is, I've actually seen it. It's lovely, and it's beautiful wood, but protect it from painting.
Okay, so
as opposed to just removal.
Yeah. Okay, so there's two questions for members of the public for staff to address.
Mr. Chair, just to answer the last one first, I don't think we're there yet. 25 Colburn is the next report that we're looking at for designation.
Right.
I'm afraid Helen has jumped ahead on us. As far as Mr. Dixon's question, certainly I can pass that on to the folks that organize the Heritage Resource Center, and I believe we've talked about that in the past, so I think it's a good suggestion, so we'll follow up.
Yeah, so Mr. Dixon, I was just there this morning talking to Lexi, and the reality of the number of listed properties, like the high number of listed properties, if we had a photo for each one up on the wall, it would probably exceed the amount of space available. So we'd have to choose which photos to put up. But there are things up. I don't, you've obviously seen the center. But there's also books with listed properties in it, bound volumes of listing going back to the early 70s, right? So there's different ways to have that available to the public in the resource center, but that's definitely, I think, part of staff's thinking already. Thank you. Yes. Yes, and the Heritage Resource Center just opened, and I'm sure the exhibits are undergoing a constant review in to best serve the public, and I'm sure staff is listening. Thank you. So now we'll need to move to the recommendation itself. Just let me get it here. So it's very straightforward. You see the recommendation in your package, the addition of these 9 properties to the City of Kingston Heritage Properties Register. So who would like to move it? Moved by Councillor Schell, seconded by Dawn. Any comment, deliberation, amendment type thing? Yes, Dawn.
Yeah, I just, as I mentioned, there's a couple of slightly misleading or puzzling things. Starting page 39, referring to 124 Ordnance Street. Second paragraph, the bottom line, the final sentence says, it has a later single-story window visible. And I don't know what that refers to. The preceding sentence refers to the central doorway, and then it continues, it has a later single-story window visible, and I'm puzzled as to what that means. Do you remember, Ryan, or anybody else?
Is he talking about the window on the door?
I don't know. That's... Does anybody in the working group recognize?
Maybe, first of all, this language is coming from a consultant's report, is it? No? Is it inherited language from something?
This one came from the working group, so I'm not entirely certain who wrote this one. So I'm not certain what that refers to. I'm happy to remove it, Mr. Chair.
I'm guessing that maybe there was a reference to a single-story addition on the left that includes a window, and somehow a couple sentences got merged or something like that.
So perhaps some words were omitted. It has a later single-story addition with a window visible.
Yeah, later addition with a
addition with. So there's two words missing. Mm-hmm. Is that possible, Ryan? We don't know where those words got missed, but if the words addition with were in there, it would make a lot more sense. Mm-hmm. With a window, I think it's 3 words. Okay, is it possible to ask the clerk, can we move forward with this with that's essentially a typo kind of thing?
Yeah, but it's just whatever staff does.
Right. So the recommendation is to add these properties to the register. That we can move forward with. The exact wording of each listing can be corrected So I guess we'll leave that with Ryan. Yes?
Just for clarity, Mr. Chair, if it helps, when the recommendation says to add to the register, really what you're adding to the register is the address.
Right.
So this information that's before you is really background information that aids in when they come in and want to remove that addition. And we look at it and go, well, is that value or the value? And so that's what these background reports are. If it's questioned, why are you adding it to the register, we can refer to these. So, but really, the motion is to add the address itself to the register.
And that also speaks to the nature of a listed property as opposed to a designated one. With designated properties, you have to list the heritage attributes, and that does have to be voted on. In listed properties, it's just the address. And then the description is very useful for staff, as Ryan just mentioned, but it's not, it doesn't have the same stature as it would if it was a Part 4 designated property. Yes, Don.
I have a couple of other ones, and so I'm just wondering whether it would be sensible not to discuss them here, but to bring them to the next meeting of the working group and do a little bit of editing, because as you say, it doesn't affect the city council resolution, but it just affects the file on the properties. So the question is, should we just not bother with this editing and just handle it in the next meeting of the working group?
That's actually exactly what the clerk was just saying to me privately. Okay. Mr. Leary, is it possible to approve, from staff's point of view, to approve this recommendation with some of the language to get further reviewed by the working group?
Mr. Chair, I would defer to the clerk on this one. I don't know what I'm happy to make the changes and send the revised ones through to the clerk for council's benefit. I can bring it back to next week's working group meeting too. So it's really doesn't make.
I'm sense. Assuming council would get the same information that we've received in this package as it stands right now.
So first answer, Councilor Stroud's last question. The agenda is provided to council. What is currently before the committee and what would council receive if it was voted on as is presented right now is the recommendation that was included in the agenda that does not reference the report itself, but just lists the 9 properties. If the committee wishes to adjust the wording, it will not, as it stands right now, impact the recommendation. It's the background material. So if there's consensus, it could be changed now. But if it's more desirable from staff in the Planning and Heritage Department to work on this over the next month or two, it doesn't really impact the recommendation as far as I understand.
So what you're also saying is that we can recommend listing of these 9 properties to council without the exact wording of the descriptions being set right now. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
Is that clear? Okay. And I know you're a member of that working group, so perhaps you can continue that. Okay. Any other comments on this one? So this recommendation to list these 9 properties, it's been moved and seconded. I'll call the question. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you very much. And thank you, Ryan. We're now at the last item of business 7A, and after that we'll get back to Roman numeral 1, which Ms. Lloyd will speak to. So there's one more item before we get there, and it's the intention to designate 25 Colburn Street, pages 55 to 81 in your package. This is a notice to designate. Sorry, Paul? They're just out in the hall talking at the moment. Well, Frank's going. They've been told. We still have quorum. We have 2 members out in the hall chatting. Okay, so we will do the notice of intention to designate. There are 2 recommendations. Before we get there, we'll get an introduction by staff and have our questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This property originated from the Cultural Heritage Property Evaluation Project. It is one that the consultants put together, the working group reviewed, and we sent to the owners, and the owners are very happy to have it. And they actually gave us a tour of this building, and we're happy to add some interior features to it as well. So The property has met the requirements under 906 for eligibility for designation. It is it includes an example of a Queen Anne style building, with some interior features such as the fireplace that has that's a carved wooden mantle with a broken pediment on the top. It's also was originally built for Clark Wright, who was a well-known hatter and furrier, and it was built in 1884. The property contributes to the character of the area, so it meets the three main tests under 906. The write-up is included in Exhibit C, of your agenda package, and there are pictures of some of the interior features in Exhibit D as well. And staff recommend, oh, and I should mention, and because I know Helen's going to ask, the alterations to interior features will be treated the same way as in alterations to exterior features. So if it's an attribute and they want to alter it, such as painting it, they do need a permit that goes through this committee and goes to staff, or goes to council, excuse me. So it's treated the same way as any other alteration. The fireplace is noted as an attribute. So, Mr. Chair, it is our recommendation that this property satisfies the tests under the Heritage Act, and that the Heritage Committee should recommend council direct the service of the notice of intention. And should we get no objection, that the clerks should, or this council should proceed with the designation of this project, of this property. Thank you.
Yes. So, questions from members of the committee, and then from members of the public. Any questions from members of the committee? Okay, I believe Ms. Finley had a question regarding the mantle.
Yes, I do. On page 67, the final cultural heritage attribute, it refers to the fireplace with carved wood mantle and to the newel post, large newel post, wooden balustrades and handrail, wooden interior doors. Now I don't see the doors. However, if you do not add varnished in there, you're liable to go in there and find it all painted white. So there's nothing that indicates that it has to retain its finish, and that is one of the things that most often gets done, and you'll never recover the patina of that wood once it's painted, because if you want to take the paint off, then you have to use a stripper, or you have to use a heat gun, or you have to use a scraper, all of which are very, very detrimental to the wood. So part of the value of this, all of the staircase, and I'm not sure about the doors. I expect they're varnished as well. I think should add that the word varnished in order to protect the finish, which is a very important part of feature of those attributes.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from members of the public on this file? Seeing none, if staff has an opportunity to address that question, and then we will move to deliberations.
Well, through you, Mr. Chair, I guess I don't have a concern with adding varnished in there. It's a more of a descriptor of what that attribute is. So if it's felt that staining of that mantle and newel post and such is a value to that property, then certainly we could add that word. I go back to my last comment, though. If they are to change anything with those attributes, they need to come to the city for permission to do that. Including painting, if they wanted to paint it, we'd look at is that hampering the value of that attribute. So, I as a descriptor, I think it may add, may help, but leaving it out as well, I think you still have the trigger in there to require the discussion, so in the review.
Thank you. That's very helpful for us with our deliberations. We see some kind of rebuttal from a member of the public. I'll allow you 1 minute.
Yeah, I just want to say I can hear a lawyer arguing about that. And they would say, you haven't referred to the finish at all. So therefore, we can do whatever we want. That is why I think you need it in there.
Okay. Great, that was 12 seconds. All right, we have now, we'll move to deliberations. We need a mover and a seconder. Are you moving?
I'm moving. I would like to ask a question of clarification.
Okay, go
though,
ahead.
Is the word varnish going to be applied only to the fireplace, or is it the intention of Ms. Finley that it should be applied to all of the wood surfaces, that they should all be that additional small amount of protection to their current condition should be added to them all. Is that the intention, or is it just the fireplace?
Okay, just hold that thought. Before that, you're discussing an amendment. Before we get there, we need to move and second the recommendation. So moved by Peter. Who's seconding the recommendation? Mac. And did you want to start talking about amendment right now, or did you want to have general comments on the designation first?
Whatever is more appropriate in the chair's judgment.
So I would suggest if you're thinking of moving amendment along the lines of Ms. Finley's suggestion, maybe you could start writing it out, and maybe you could even go over and ask Ms. Finley the question that you just asked, and that would help with your amendment, and then we will continue on with the applications in general. Yes, Bob and then Mac.
I would suggest that this would be the time to include it, and it only need the addition of that one word, varnished, in relation to the newel post and balustrade, as well as the mantelpiece.
Okay.
A very small change, and very little effort to change it. So I would certainly support any motion to add.
So no further comments on a theoretical amendment are in order. When we have the amendment, we will discuss it. Until then, it's general comments on the designation itself. Anything else about the application? Or about the item? Yes, Don.
I noticed a mistake, a minor mistake throughout, where mantle is spelt L-E instead of E-L. I assume that can be corrected without requiring an amendment.
Mantle L-E would be something you wear. Mantle E-L is where what goes above the fireplace, according to Oxford. Okay. So noted. I see some, it could be that the American spelling is L-E. I'm not sure about that. Someone will consult a dictionary. All right. So do you have your written amendment?
Thank you. I'm proposing that we add as an amendment a final sentence which says wood surfaces should to this last bullet. Wood surfaces should retain their varnished finishes.
Okay, so just ask a question to staff before, we need to second it actually. Who's going to second Peter's amendment? Councillor Schell, just a question to staff. If adding the sentence at the end of the last bullet is clear in its language to the intent of protecting those varnish finishes that were already mentioned.
Mr. Chair, I hate to disagree with the member, but I think what the motion you're putting together now is more of a direction for a permit than it would be for a designation. You're testing me good today, so. my understanding is the list of attributes should be the things that need to be preserved on this property. So you need to couch it in a way that it's describing the feature that needs to be conserved, not what you're doing with the feature. So if the committee agrees that feature being varnished is of value, that it needs to be kept that way, then you need to describe it as the wooden balustrade that is varnished wooden feature, or whatever the feature is.
For example, varnished carved wood mantle and varnished newel post and varnished wooden balustrade, as opposed
correct.
To putting it all together in as is proposed.
Correct. Yeah.
That's a different amendment, or an amendment to an amendment. So we will have to.
Well,
Okay, so we need to deal with this amendment first. Yeah, and Ms. Finley, you're not a member of the committee, so you're not allowed to approach members while they sit.
The suggestion is that add the word varnished twice, so that the sentence would read elements of the interior, including the main floor mantel piece with carved, add the word varnished wood mantel that extends, elements of a two-story staircase, and then balustrades, wooden varnished balustrades and handrail.
Right. Okay, so I will allow you to withdraw your First Amendment.
Thank you.
And that's we don't need to vote on that. It's withdrawn with the consent of your seconder. Yeah. Okay. So now you're working on a written amendment, specifically altering the language of that last bullet. So you need to write it in relation to that bullet. And if you'd rather rewrite the whole sentence, you're going to need some time. If you're just adding words, you could do so as well. Do you have it ready?
I haven't rewritten it. I'm proposing adding the word in the first line, varnished between carved and wood. And in the third last line, between wooden and balustrades, adding varnished.
Okay, so adding the word varnished twice?
Yes.
Correct? So if you just put that...
Sorry. I'm a slow learner.
This is exactly why the mayor always wants things in writing.
Varnished elements in line three. Add varnished elements in line three. So there are three varnished. Carved varnished wood in line one, in line three. After molded motifs and the semicolon, then varnished elements of the two-story staircase. And then in the next line, varnished wood interior. Forget the what I said.
Okay, so the you had said wooden varnished balustrades. Well, that's one of the elements.
Ignore that. That's superseded by the
right.
So there are now three varnished, carved varnished wood in line three, varnished element in line one, varnished elements in line three, and in the next line, varnished wooden interior doors. I'm sorry for that confusion.
Okay, so the amendment proposed is to add the word varnished in three places, which the member will now write out, and it needs to be seconded. Oh, he has it already.
But just to confirm, Mr. Goheen, so it's carved varnished wood in the first sentence. After the semicolon in the third sentence, it's varnished elements of the two-story staircase. And finally, after the next semicolon, varnished wood and interior.
Thank you. That's correct. Thank you.
Yeah. So seconded by, just one sec. By Councillor Schell. So now we are discussing this amendment only, the addition of the word varnished in three places. Yes, Paul.
Is that part of the recommendation, or is actually, this is just Exhibit A. So this is this documentation. And the same wording is also on 79 in Exhibit C. So I'm
79?
Not.
79?
Yes.
Perhaps I can help with that, Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
The amendment you'll want to make is on page 79. Exhibit C is the actual bylaw on page, it starts on page 76 and goes through 79.
Right, so the proposed amendment's correct place is in the bylaw, correct, Mr. Clerk?
And furthermore, Exhibit C in the recommendation will refer to the amendment, just for clarification, so.
Yes, so thank you for pointing that out. So we're talking about the wording in the bylaw, proposed bylaw, which is Schedule A of Exhibit C, starting on page 78. That's the actual legislation that will be passed by council if approved. And you'll see at the bottom of page 79 the identical wording. So if you've been following on page 67, everything we've said applies, but it applies to the bylaw, which starts on page 78. Okay. So on the amendment only, to add the word varnished in three places of that bullet. Yes, Mac.
So I have a little bit of trouble with defining paint colors and varnish colors inside buildings. I don't have any problem with the fireplace or the newel post. I certainly would be opposed to it. Is this also presuming that the baseboards would always have to be varnished as well? Is that part of?
I don't believe that was part of the amendment.
Okay.
We haven't got the written version.
And the wooden interior doors?
Have you finished writing out the three spots? And the clerk has them?
Yes, the clerk has them, I believe.
Okay, so I'm just going to read out the amendment.
Could I just hear it once more, please?
Yeah, read it out the amendment so we know what we're talking about. Yeah, so the clerk will read out the amendment, the addition of the word varnished and where it goes.
So the recommendation as amended will read as follows, and then I'll pop it up on the screen in a second. Elements of the interior, including the main floor fireplace with carved insert varnished wood, mantle that extends to a broken pediment, metal insert porcelain tile work with cobalt majolica glaze and molded motifs. And then after the semicolon, include varnished elements of the two-story staircase, such as the large newel posts, wooden balustrades, and handrail. And after the semicolon again is to say varnished wooden interior doors, including iron hinges and hardware, large baseboard and plaster ceiling medallions.
I think that the semicolon after hinges and hardware is significant, and then large baseboards and plaster ceiling medallions are not modified by the word varnished as I submitted this.
Well, maybe I'll go to staff for a minute. Regarding designation bylaws, does the addition of this adjective in three places with all the semicolons make that particular clause unclear for designation purposes?
I guess that depends on where you sit, Mr. Chair. I mean, what you're doing is you're saying those features in that type of stain are of such value that they have to be conserved, and that color of stain, or that the fact that it is stained, is part of its value. So the committee has to be comfortable that that's what they want to do. Whether it's fair or not, I guess that's depending on where you sit. It's the same as any of the other attributes. They're the features that define that heritage value.
Thank you for clarifying. That's very useful to know what exactly it is that is being proposed. But I guess my specific question right now is whether, as read, this amendment would suggest that the baseboards would need to be varnished, would need to be maintained, considering that there's a semicolon after hardware. Is the semitone sufficient to the clarity of the clause when you add another word that has to do with the finish of the elements?
When I wrote this, my intent was to separate things by the semicolons. So when you refer to the varnished elements of the two-story staircase, and then it talks about those various elements, those are part of that, those elements of the two-story staircase. And then the semicolons divide that among other elements of the interior feature. So yes, I'm reading it the same way you are, I believe, Mr. Chair. And again, any alterations to any of those features would have to come through a heritage permit process. So.
Okay, so that's the answer to your question, Mac. Go ahead.
So are all the doors in the house varnished?
would say, Mr. Chair, no, they're not. There are certainly the significant ones are, but there are a number of doors in that, in that unit. So perhaps if you're considering adding the word varnish, you need to be specific what doors you're talking about. I think the ones that we're referring to are the main doors coming into the building, and I believe there are a large set of doors going into the first apartment and a large set dividing the two rooms of the apartment. But there are certainly, as you can imagine, there are, I think, three apartments in that building, so there are a variety of doors, wooden doors, I believe, for the most part.
So he's put it up on the screen here to make sure that's everyone's understood what we're discussing here, but then he needs to take it down again and continue typing minutes. So has everyone seen what's up there and understands what we're discussing? Yes, Laura?
Well, can I just call on the fact that I'm an English professor for a second here and say that it seems to me that this only refers to those doors that are varnished at the moment, I would suggest. And I would also say that it doesn't suggest the baseboards and plaster ceiling medallions have to be varnished.
Thank you for that syntactical analysis. He's going to pull that down now, and he's going to go back to his other typing. So anything further on the addition of the word varnish in those three places? Mac?
I'll be voting against this amendment. I just have real trouble with defining the colors inside. I mean, I could maybe deal with it with the newel posts and the handrail and the fireplace, but I think, you know, I mean, there could be varnish doors upstairs, those front doors. I don't know. I just, you know, I'll be voting against the amendment.
Okay, any other comments or deliberations on this amendment only? Seeing none, I will call the question on the amendment. All those in favor of adding the word varnished as indicated? Opposed? And that passes with a split vote. Okay, we're back to the recommendation as a whole. Any other comments? Where are we? Okay, so the recommendation as a whole, to remind everyone, is speaking to designation under Part 4 of the Heritage Act. Yes, Don.
I have a problem with the wording on page 63. Now, I guess that may not be part of the bylaw, so it really doesn't matter, but I think probably for the sake of the file, I think it's worth mentioning. Near the bottom of page 3, three lines from the bottom, it says, the tiles appear to be porcelain, which date from the late 1700s to present. Now, that's a very misleading statement. I think it should say, which could date from the late 1700s to the present, because then it goes on to say that it probably is sort of Victorian or something like that. But I would suggest we need to add the word could, which could date, because that was a period when that style of finish was
so are you suggesting that as written the description is misleading?
I think it is. I think that reading it casually, you might think it could actually date from the 1700s.
Yeah, so this does not require an amendment. It requires staff to understanding what's being proposed. So he's saying that it's ambiguous in its current wording.
I would say, Mr. Chair, that this is simply the report from the consultants and their background work. That particular phrase did not make it into the bylaws, so there's really, I can certainly make the change for record-keeping purposes, but as far as what before this committee and the designating bylaw, yeah, it has no bearing.
That didn't suggest that he suggested the clear wording could be. Right. So procedurally, you have to point out, this is a consultant's report. We don't have the power to amend a consultant's report. Mm-hmm. However, James is making note in the minutes of Don's suggestion that that sentence could be better worded. Anything else? Okay, so then without further ado, we will vote on the amended recommendation. I'll just read it out before we do. Back. Okay, a recommendation that council serve a notice of intention to designate the property located at 25 Colburn Street, known as the Clark Wright House, as a property of cultural heritage value or interest pursuant to section 29 of the OHA, as attached as Exhibit B to report MHC 16-009, and that should no notice of objection be received by the clerk of the Corporation of the City of Kingston within 30 days of the serving of the notice of intention to designate, that council approve the designation by law for 25 Colburn Street, known as the Clark Wright House, as attached as Exhibit C to report MHC 16-009. And, sorry, Exhibit C as amended to report MHC 16-009. So this is the amended recommendation. The amendment, of course, was in the heritage attributes, which form part of the bylaw. Okay, I'll call the question. All those in favor of the recommendation? And opposed? Passed unanimously. Thank you. As amended. Okay, now, Ms. Lloyd, we are back to the to where we were, not to the beginning, but to where we were on 7A Roman numeral 1. So, if you notice where we are now. We're jumping back to application for heritage permit for the signs at 340 King Street East. And we've already had the briefing from staff. We've already had deliberations and we've had some questions. Actually, we haven't had deliberations. We've only had questions. And we're back to the end of the question phase. And Ms. Lloyd is going to answer the question on behalf of the sign designer, I hope. Go ahead, Ms. Lloyd.
In the meantime, we have for you drawings that were to have been part of your package and somehow were not. I expect that's a little difficult to read. Amy, did you want to read it for everybody?
Well, there's also hard copies that can be passed around, but the detail that I'm reading on this is that there's a 4-inch or a carrier box that the lettering will actually be installed onto, or a panel, a rectangular panel that's shown just below the bracket on the cornice there. So that would answer Mac's question, I think, on how the lighting's to be illuminated. It's on a carrier box backing. And the gooseneck lighting is shown underneath the cornice with the spacing to avoid the cornice detail. I also see the detail that Bob was asking about just below here. That's not affected, but is partially obscured in certain areas, but in isolated. On the far left, I understand that to be the cocoa component of the sign, the middle wording, and then the smaller portion with the lighting would be the chocolate and bistro component. That's how I'm reading it.
Okay, so if you remember what we were discussing, so these are questions about the sign and how it would interact with the existing facade. Mac, did you want to pick up your line of questioning, or has it been answered?
No, I think it answers my questions. You know, on the rendering, it looked like the letters just stand alone. So I wonder how that happened. And clearly they are mounted onto a box. And I presume the box will probably be painted the same color as the trim behind, so it doesn't stand out, and the lettering be lighted to make the lettering stand out. So I'm fine with that.
And Bob, did you have anything further about your question on the lineup?
Yeah, so the lighting is quite clear here. This is what I was hoping might have been in our package. It explains a lot.
Yes, it helps to have accurate drawings. Okay, so I will allow any other questions regarding the technical aspects of the signs at this point before we move to deliberations. Are there any others? Seeing none, I need a mover and a seconder for the recommendation. Moved by Floyd, seconded by Mac. No, I think we were just in question phase. Or we moved it, did we move it so that we could defer it? We'll find out, I can't remember. Okay, so we were actually only at questions from the committee, and then we council shall move deferral. So members of the public have a chance to comment or ask questions to staff or the agent. Yes, go ahead, come over here.
Okay, so I've written this out so that'll make it easier for the clerk. I did speak with Ms. Lloyd about this just in the interval. I walk by there quite often, and my concern is with the Rochelle Court section, which apparently does it count as part of the property. So this is an interior passage going in towards Shea Piggy and the pubs in there, Kirkpatrick's and the Toucan and so forth. It's a three-pronged passage. So my concern is with the drain that's just inside the entrance to the court.
I'm just gonna stop you there because I wanted to see where you were going. I'm sorry, Mr. Dixon, but the application only is about the facade and the signage. It's not about the passageway or the drain.
Okay.
So you understand that this is an application not about the entire property, but it's not designation or anything like that. This is just the application for a permit to build a sign as described. So perhaps it is in order for your comments to be passed on to the owners, but it's not something for the Heritage Committee to consider.
Okay, I'll accept your ruling.
Okay, thank you. Any other members of the public? Okay, so now we need to go to deliberations on the recommendation. I need a mover for the recommendation. You see there on page 2 of our package. It's all to do with the signage. So moved by Mac, seconded by Paul. So there's recommendation, you see there, and then there's 4 conditions. And that's what we would be voting on unless there's any deliberations. Anyone wish to speak? Okay, well, we'll vote on the recommendation verbatim, which is in the package. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. Congratulations. Thank you very much, Ms. Lloyd. So then, we're done with section 7A, so now we go to section 7B, which is working group reports. There's 3 working groups. We have in the package a report from the third one. This is your opportunity to address the first two if you have anything to say, if you happen to participate on one of the first 2 working groups. Yes, Ed? Receive. Okay, moved by Ed that the briefing notes from the Historic Properties Research Working Group be received by the committee. I need a seconder. Seconded by Bob. Any comments? Okay, all those in favor of receiving? Opposed? Carried. All right, seeing no further hands, we'll go to the next item, which is 7C, update regarding delegated authority approvals. February 2016, there were none. Item 8 is motions, there are none. 9 is notices of motion, seeing none. Number 10 is other business. I believe Don wanted an update from the transition team. I guess I might as well go ahead. Unless Councillor Shell. Yeah. We spoke about it at council. It was reported in the in the news. If you didn't watch it, the discussion lasted almost an hour. Mac was on the transition team. Councillor Shell was on the transition team. I was on the transition team. That's half the transition team. The other members being Bill Visser, who I believe I see at the back there. Yes, the chair of the museum, MACAC, and also Colin and Paige. That was the entire transition team led by the facilitator, who is George Wallace. We had five meetings, each at least 2 hours in length. We had many interesting discussions. One of the significant changes during the deliberations was suggested by MAC that we have 9 members from the public rather than 7, which was originally proposed, and that was adopted. The deliberations at council centered around my amendment to add the word required on the 4 most crucial types of qualifications that were identified by staff in the transition team report. All of this is available online in cityofkingston.ca. Also was written up, like I say, in a couple of news outlets. So the word that was eventually adopted after the First Amendment failed on a 6-6 tie to add the word required was to add the word prioritize. So the 4 qualifications council felt most important out of the list of 8 were the word prioritize was added. This is to help the nominations committee make their selections from the list of applicants. So transition team's work is done. It was very useful, in my opinion, and although I didn't get every little thing that I went to bat for in the final version, the end result is I'm very comfortable with personally. I don't know if Councillor Shaw wanted to say anything else about that, or Mac, if you want to say anything about the transition team's work before. I mean, it's out of our hands. This is council's already approved it. So did you want to take the opportunity to say anything about it right now, Mac?
The only thing I'd like to say is not directly to that, is just that this will probably be the last time this group sits together. I believe for the next meeting will be our new committee. Are you going to talk about that at all? Or?
That was my next item for other business. Okay. Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah. Go ahead.
We know that heritage culturally has become more and more important in the city. The Heritage Resource Center has been an incredible addition to a city that hadn't really had a heritage department, except in terms of built heritage. So it's really quite a huge step, I think, that we're taking to try to have, even in discussions of the culture plan, every time somebody said cultural heritage, what they meant was built heritage. And it took ages to even figure out that there were cultural parts to the city that were part of the built heritage, like the stories behind these buildings. When we tick off, it's a significant building because of the family. We never emphasized any of that in the city, and now that's part of what the new Heritage Kingston's all about. The families behind the stories, how the city grew, and the individual buildings and protecting them. So it's really quite a big move we're making, and I hope it all works. That'll be up to the committee once we get rolling. Thank you.
Actually, I would like to say something if I could.
Yeah, go ahead, Mac.
My understanding of going to the committee was, I mean, obviously amalgamating the cultural and the museums and the heritage and the built heritage. And I was hoping that we were going to find some way of making our process more quick. I don't think we did. I think we failed on that, which is unfortunate for various reasons. But I do believe also that this new agenda is to be looked at in a year's time. And if, you know, if things aren't working, could look at making adjustments one way or the other.
Yeah, just sitting as an independent member of council, not as chair, I agree with Mac's statement that that we didn't necessarily identify ways to improve the efficiency of the permit application process. Several things were discussed and proposed, and the final transition team's report reflects the the consensus on the transition team after consultation with staff. So I guess I'll leave it there for that. I did want to say something, though, before I consider this a separate item. It's sort of a summary statement of the work of this committee before we dissolve for the last time and adjourn. But I'll allow anyone else under other business, if they want to say anything about their work here. Yes, go ahead, Bob.
Just a question. Because the Ontario Heritage Act deals with built heritage primarily, perhaps it should go further. However, you're trying to combine built heritage with other heritage initiatives. Did you find that difficult to combine with this new approach?
That's kind of similar to a question CKWS asked me earlier. I'm not, and I answered him, and it may be on the news tonight, but. That's essentially the question is how do you do that? And that's what the transition team was discussing.
In my view, built heritage involves these other aspects of heritage as well. And it's just a roundabout way of getting to it. It's through the built heritage. But with built heritage, you can't ignore those other aspects of our heritage, whatever it is.
Thank you, Bob. Well, that's sort of I'll go to Paul first because I sort of have a prepared statement. Go ahead.
In regards to those four prioritized, can you say what they were, or is that you said they're on the line? Well, you were mentioning how you prioritize. What's the requirements?
Sorry, I didn't hear
that. The requirements for the committee? You said you. You did
the actual requirements for yes. The nominations. Yeah, it's I could pull it up. Is it in here? The bullets, it's in Schedule B. Just off the top of my head, there was 8 bullets that talked about different types of qualifications, and the 4 that got the word prioritized. One of them was the museum experience with museum sector. I don't remember the exact wording, we can find it. One of them was trades work on heritage structures, which I understood to be like Mac and Jonathan represent right now. One of them was archaeological history, which was also very important. And then the fourth one was, or the first one actually was, we said architecture, it must be. Hang on, you found it on the page?
Got my nominations.
Oh, okay, there you go.
And it's cultural heritage, local history, and historical research prioritized, architectural history prioritized, architectural heritage conservation approaches and trades work prioritized, and museum policy development, collections development, management prioritized.
Thank you. Does that answer your question? Okay, so that's a nice segue into what I had prepared to say. So we all know what actually this means for us as members of the Municipal Heritage Committee is that there's a new committee coming, and the door has been open to everyone to apply to that. But before we even think about that, I'd like to just say, give you a historical perspective, because when this is a crossroads that we just went to, and we're at it now, we're at the last paragraph perhaps of the final chapter of the Municipal Heritage Committee, and so maybe we should look at it in historical perspective. And so I did a little bit of I asked staff to prepare a little bit for me, and I did a little bit of digging myself. So basically, just to go back to the beginning, so 1970, after presumably some buildings were lost in Kingston, there was a movement afoot to do something about preservation of heritage. At that point, there was no Ontario Heritage Act or any kind of protection whatsoever. There was just, it was a grassroots movement that came out of the community. 1970, there was the Kingston Act, which is municipal here in Kingston. And that inspired the Ontario Heritage Act of 1975, which, in a manner unprecedented at the time, was announced here in Kingston at City Hall, even though it's provincial legislation that's normally announced at Queen's Park, and that was had never been done before, which is a great way of saying, basically, we in Kingston, not me personally, because I was only 6 years old at the time, but we in Kingston were responsible for the Ontario Heritage Act and getting that started. And it was a movement. So it was a movement that came out of the community. All of us are familiar with other types of movements, but this one resulted in the Ontario Heritage Act. And we had, in the early days, a group called LACAC, which some of you are very familiar with. That was until 2001, it was called LACAC, which is already 15 years ago. And then it was briefly called the Heritage Kingston Advisory Committee, and then it was called the Municipal Heritage Committee. And the number of members has been fairly steady between 6 and 10 from the community. And at one point there was a planning committee member on the committee in the 90s. One of the former mayors of Kingston has been mentioned in the early days, Mayor Swain. Part of his popularity was due to his work with heritage building preservation. All this to say that we do have a bit of a unique situation here in Kingston when it comes to heritage. There's also the Frontenac Heritage Foundation, which arose in the 70s as well. I believe, is that not right, Floyd? 70s? The Frontenac Heritage Foundation, 72? Yeah, around the same time for the same reasons, which is also going today and remains a community group with a lot of important community work. There's also the Kingston Historical Society that's been involved, but they date back over 100 years. So the Municipal Heritage Committee is a advisory committee to council. It advises council directly. That's the form it's in now. This next chapter is Heritage Kingston is an evolution of the Municipal Heritage Committee. So, because although the buildings stay relatively, you know, their timeline is very long, longer than any human life, they span several generations. The human interaction with them changes at the speed of humans, which in politics is actually very quickly. So you see the nature of the Municipal Heritage Committee or the new Heritage Kingston is actually how do you put those two things together? And I have a lot of questions. I don't have a lot of answers. I'm happy to be part of the new committee and I will be volunteering. I'd love to see each and every one of you part of that new committee. There's one less spot. That doesn't mean that all of you couldn't be there. It means all but one, I suppose. There probably are others that have applied. That is out of my hands now. I'm not part of the nominations committee. Regardless of who gets on, there's room at all of the working groups. For example, Helen sits on the Heritage Properties Working Group and has for some time, and is very productive in that manner. And I know that is just as important, and I would like to see people, I would like to see everyone here still involved. I don't want anyone to think that this is somehow some kind of, some kind of a conspiracy to change the way we deal with heritage. It's a benign evolution of the process, in my view, and by staying involved, I'll be able to continually have my say. And basically, no matter what happens, we've done some good work here, and we were part of Kingston's history directly, right? Every building that we discussed is a living testament to the work of this committee. Every bit of legislation that we helped get passed, every description of every building, this is the creation of history. History is a fluid thing. I'm sure there are people here that know much more about that than I, but there are stories in Kingston that exist today that have not intersected with the Heritage Committee as of yet, and perhaps they should. There are different versions of events that have happened, and we haven't come to an agreement of how to deal with that. Everybody agrees that there's more than one perspective, both in the political spectrum, but also in how you describe your past. And, you know, one day I will hopefully have grandchildren, and I will want to be able to tell them stories, and I'd love to be able to take them to the Heritage Resource Center. I'd love to be able to take them around town to all these buildings and say, look, this is your town. This is where you live. And there's so many stories here that I don't even know them. But you know everything, Daddy. No, I don't. It's like, this is something that makes me feel like a child. And, you know, I'll never stop caring about the heritage of Kingston. And we need this movement to continue. We need the people to care. And it's up to us to convince the people of Kingston how important this is. And that's why I just took 5 minutes out of this committee to make that summary. It's now 3:15. When we do adjourn, I'd like to invite everyone to get together for a beverage at a nearby, hopefully, heritage location. And then we can continue an informal discussion in a non-meeting of the committee, because we are permitted to do so, because after we adjourn, this committee no longer will be meeting again to discuss official city business, and therefore the quorum rules do no longer apply once we adjourn. Does anyone have any last words of farewell to say? Yes, Floyd.
So on behalf of this group here, and maybe anyone who's not here, I think we should recognize the competence of our chair and thank him for being diligent and really caring about the cause.
Thank you, Floyd. And of course, before we stop, I'd like to first of all thank Chris Brown, Lexi Feinstein, and James here for helping me with my research for today's last day. And also, we should all have a quick round of applause for Amy, who is Amy Didrikston, who's leaving us to a different position as a reward for her great work here on the Heritage File. And so if you can mind putting your hands together for Amy. We haven't heard about Ryan, so I presume you're staying on Heritage Matters, which gives me great comfort. Okay, well, I'm after we adjourn, I'm going to shake each of your hands, so don't take off right away. And any parting comments? If not, I'm looking at, yes.
I just ask, what is the status of the Historic Properties Research Working Group? Because it has one more meeting.
Schedule B of the bylaw, or the bylaw that was replaced, that was approved at council, states that the committee remains in effect until March 31st, I believe. So I imagine it's appropriate for the working group to conclude its happenings.
So we operate until dissolution on March 31st. Thank you. I just wish to clarify.
You're talking about the working group.
The working group. Yes.
Yeah, and they have another meeting. So yeah, the none of this is the end of the working group. Yes, Commissioner Hurdle.
Thank you, and through you, Mr. Chair. So the new committee will continue to have the historic property working group. So I want to make sure that it's clear that that working group is not disappearing or going away after March 31st, even though the new committee is going to be in place.
Correct. There's three working groups in the transition team report, and that one was actually not proposed any changes to that one. Okay, well, I need a motion to adjourn. Moved by Jonathan, seconded by Don. Before we do, I've just remembered something. I asked for a list of past chairs of the Heritage Committee, and staff wasn't able to find all that in one place. So if anyone here actually knows some of those names, I'd love to get a list started and see if we can trace it back to the 41 years to when we started, and perhaps get a get something made up that would have the listing of that to recognize that work, because I know that Don here preceded me as chair of this committee. Oh, okay, as vice chair. My intention was the chairs and vice chairs. So anyway, that's another thing I was thinking of doing, but that's not time sensitive. Okay, so it's time to adjourn. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you very much.